I am here standing on the deck that Don Kaiser built, and I'm here to talk with him today at his home in the beauty of the surroundings right by Lake Massapanock. I can see straight ahead. It's a gorgeous view and it's a gorgeous setting here, and I really look forward to hearing what Don has to say about what he has created here at his home and from his life. Hi, Don. Thank you for having me at your home here in Hopkinton today next to Lake Massapanock, which is just gorgeous in this fall weather. And your house is amazing. It's one of my favorites I can think of. It's so creative and connected to nature. I'm so glad we could be outside in your yard today.
Yes, I'm definitely an outdoor person. I always want to be outside. Mm-hmm. Not handle an office job. Mm-hmm. There's no way.
Yeah. Yeah. So you're on the job taking a break right now because this is your office in a way, outdoors here in your yard or someone else's or home.
And it works for me. I have a doctor's appointment today, but I normally try to work a 4-day week. Mm-hmm. I've done that most of my adult life. And
most of your life you have a 4-day work week. Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's much better.
Yeah.
It always seemed like the fifth day always went to taxes anyway, so.
that's a good prescription, I think.
Yeah. And doing construction work involves site visits with customers and, fixing tools and arranging things. And that allows me to do that on that day off when I'm not actually on a job site working.
Mm-hmm.
And so it keeps me a little more centered.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know people in this business that sometimes spend 10, 12 hours a week on top of their 40-hour week to keep that rolling.
Yeah.
And, then you're not working Saturdays and evenings you're out. And, life's too short.
Yes.
Too much fun things to do.
Yes. Well, I think you have a way of teaching that through your life and work, what I know of you. And so you have... your work, you mentioned in construction, you are a master carpenter.
Yes.
In your work title, and you live here in Hopkinton. How many years have you been?
32.
Here? 32 years you've lived in this home. And,
yes.
I don't think it's always looked this way, has it? Now, how did you start out here?
It was a little white 4-room box. Mm-hmm. It was 21 by 26 feet. The bathroom was in the basement. The outhouse in the backyard didn't work anymore. It was too far gone.
An outhouse.
Yeah.
And how old do you think the outhouse was?
It was probably built in the 30s, probably when the house was originally built.
Okay.
That's kind of essential to having a house is having an outhouse or a bathroom.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And there might still be some outhouses that are still standing in this neighborhood.
Oh, that's
probably
interesting.
None of them are being used, but,
Interesting part of history. And then the transformation, in addition to your work, working on your own home here. And so I would like to ask you a little bit about your work and then go on to your house. In being in construction as a master carpenter, what would you say brought you to this work in the first place? What directed you?
My high school sweetheart's father ran a construction company. So when I finished high school, after I did my first semester of college, I worked for my summer's semester's off for him.
Mm-hmm.
And it was bigger construction than commercial construction. And I continued to work for him for years on and off while I was in and out of the Army and back into school. And at one point, as I was debating going to grad school and versus working, I got a job offer from a friend to do a project for them. And left the contractor I was working for and never went back.
Wow.
Because I've just always had a full load of work. And often I've been backed up a year or more.
So that's a good problem to have in a way, right?
I've been extremely lucky.
And what would you say, what was that project that led you to independent work from?
It was a house in Wayland on top of a hill. A friend of mine who was actually being chased for welfare fraud at the time met this man who had lots of money. I didn't know. They asked me about building a deck, and I went to this house, and it's on 6 acres in the middle of somebody's 1,000-acre estate with a view of Mount Monadnock and a big architectural house with 5, maybe 7 bathrooms. I don't even remember.
Wow.
And so we built a massive addition with 6 by 7 foot oval hot tub and redwood beamed roof and redid the kitchen and lots of things. It was fun.
And that was your first independent project?
That was, yeah.
Wow. Uh-huh. That's a nice way to start.
Yeah. It worked. Mm-hmm.
And then the business kept going by word of mouth. And
yeah. Just always had work. Mm-hmm. Wow, it's been nice. And most of the people that I've worked for, I know lots of people from doing different kinds of organizing work and being involved in different things. Mm-hmm. So having contacts like that rather than having to advertise is really helpful. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the joy of that has been that most of my customers are personal friends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I go to their house, we fix something, we create something, we make it better, they pay me, they feed me, they're happy, I'm happy.
Uh-huh.
Who gets a job description like that?
Right.
Who gets a job like that?
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, so, congratulations to you. How many years?
And I fell into that. I didn't, set out to create that.
Uh-huh. Right. Would you say that there was anything back in time when you were a child that set you on a path unknowingly or offered you the talents in a way? Or
I did some small woodworking projects as a kid, and then through school I did a two-day a week metalworking shop from part of 7th or 8th grade, and I loved that. But that was it. If you're on a college track and you live in Wellesley, you don't get to do shop courses anymore. I did some drafting classes, but on some level, if I could have done the shop work and done other things, I probably would have liked that, because I was very hyperactive and not always in love with being a student. I found always having projects hanging over your head, papers to write and stuff, stressful, because I was one of those people that put it off to the last night.
Got through. And then ran outside.
And then ran outside. I always wanted to be outside. I've always been an outdoor person. That's been a handicap for me in my adult life, because my son's like that. And he's never taught me anything about computers. I'm still, I'm technologically behind because I don't, haven't had a son that taught me. And
has done the same work.
He does the same work too. And he's an outdoor kid. Which has been one of the marvels of living here, is that we have, not only do we have a beautiful lake to swim in and canoe in and play in, we also have miles of trails in the woods right here.
And so you go hiking often?
Oh, yeah.
Being right on the hiking trails. I know it's gorgeous territory out there.
Yeah, I walk in the woods every morning with the dog. Usually after I swim or something, and I go out in the boat. And
so you swim every day?
From sometime in May till usually September, sometimes into October, depending on the water temperature.
What an ideal setting, place to be in town, to be able to do that. You get hiking, hills. Yes. And swimming in the lake. And
you get the woods, the birds.
I see a lot of birds here right now. It's a good place to be. And a wonderful recollection of your work experience also. And I think you've talked about what you love about it, and being outdoors is part of that for you also.
Yeah. Even when I work in somebody's house doing their kitchen or something, I often set up my tools and equipment outdoors, so I'm doing all my cutting and dusty work outside, so I'm in and out a lot. It's nice.
Yes, yeah. And through the winter also?
Yeah, the winter's very, it's nice to sort of have in your back pocket an inside job, a basement or something to do in the winter, but often we have winters that are mild enough that you can work around things.
And another perk, from what I understand, is that you have flexibility being an independent carpenter, and you can take off and travel, which is part of a life passion for you, too.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And I see we have a camper here.
An Airstream camper.
An Airstream camper, and it's
beautiful. That's my wife's fantasy. She surprised me one night. She said, "You want to go look at this camper show in town?" And we've motorcycle camped. We've gone all the way to Alaska done months outdoors, living in a tent.
In a tent in Alaska.
She likes a tent. I often don't like to set the tent up because I'd just soon sleep under the stars. But
On the ground.
On the ground. She needs a tent. Still like the camp, tent camp. But the Airstream's it suits her and it's her fantasy and it's been wonderful. And I enjoy it.
Uh-huh.
I often am puzzled that we spend very little time sitting around a campfire anymore because the camper is so cozy.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Well, it's beautiful. And yeah. It sounds like you've traveled around a lot of the country. Can you name a few places you've
The only been? State I haven't been in is Hawaii.
Whoa.
I've hit all the states.
Wow.
I've done many cross-country motorcycle trips. And when my son turned 16 and got his learner's permit, we ended up, he didn't want to go in the motorcycle sidecar rig, so we ended up buying a convertible to do a cross-country trip and do the coast highway. We ended up getting a little Geo Tracker. Which was really nice because the back seats were higher than the front seats, so you could really see. Mm-hmm. A lot of convertibles in the back seat, you feel like you're in a hole. Which is not good for touring when you're out
It sounds like great fun, though. Oh, nice. Good way to see the country.
My son got to drive the to the Sun Road in Glacier Park.
Wow.
I'm standing up on the back seats, holding the onto the roll bar, and their heads are down here. I'm well up above the vehicle. It's like not even being on a motorcycle. It's just like I'm there in the mountains.
How about that? That sounds like a good moment.
Yeah.
And where would you say is one of your favorite spots in all the country, seeing so much of it by on the road?
Yeah, that's hard. Although I did wonder this year, we do a lot of national parks.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been to Yellowstone many times. I've decided that on some level, Yellowstone's my favorite. There are hot springs and hot rivers to swim in. The wildlife is incredible. Mm-hmm. The first time I went to Yellowstone, I saw one bison.
Wow.
The last couple of times there, I've been in the middle of whole herds. Mm-hmm. One evening we're there and they're moving like a flock of birds on this field, a whole herd of buffalo bison. It's just incredible. Mm-hmm.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
Some great sights and interesting people, I imagine you've met.
Always when you travel. I've traveled alone by motorcycle.
Yeah.
And I did a cross-country trip once, and I really wanted to experience loneliness because I was involved in Clamshell Alliance and a bunch of things here, and I always felt like wherever I went, I ran into friends.
Mm.
And, well, when you travel alone on a motorcycle, people invite you over. When you pull into a campground, people come over and talk to you. They invite you over to have dinner with them. So it was... when you travel with a group, you're a little more insular.
Right.
But when people see you alone... They want
reach
to include
out to you.
Yeah.
We all should be riding on motorcycles by ourselves sometimes.
Yes.
Connecting more. That's a great thing to hear.
Yeah.
Encouraging. So, well, I am happy for you and your adventures in work as well as travel and having the flexibility, you know, recognizing that you didn't have to... find a particular or create a particular type of work that you, what did you say, you it came to you.
Came to me.
And it was natural. And then there you go. It created your life in a way that you love.
Yeah.
So how about talking about your work here at home, also what you've created, which is just remarkable. It's beautiful. How'd you get started with this?
Well, the house was really small, so it needed to be bigger. And I've been fortunate enough being self-employed that I've been able to take blocks of time off to do projects on my own house.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to do projects nights and weekends will drive you crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And I've taken blocks of time off, and we at one point did a major design where we added this part of the addition and the whole addition and back. It's the two-story bedroom and family room, and then after we finished that, a few years later, we did the front room, the front porch.
That's Bear.
That's Bear, our dog. Bear, it's okay. The front porch on this had jalousy windows that you could kind of muscle your hand open and get your fist through. They were so loose, so there was kind of that room needed to be fixed. So I took the whole room off the house and brought it forward, cantilevered it, and kind of bowed the front a little and raised the roof and put skylights in and made it a much nicer room. Then I redid the kitchen.
So how long of a process has it been to totally transform this?
Well, I haven't done any major changes in a while, so maybe 15 years or something.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, things happen. At one point we decided my son's bedroom, which was still an 8 by 9 inch room, we put a tower on that, bumped the room out, put a bay on it, and then went up into an octagonal loft room for him.
Wow. How cool is that for a young person?
Really.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And here in Hopkinton, he joked about kids, some of his friends having, you know, walk-in closets that were bigger than his bedroom.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Mm-hmm. But not everybody has a loft.
Yeah. It doesn't really matter. There are many more things important in life.
Right.
And the big spaces tend to lose intimacy.
That's right.
You know,
yes.
I've been in some big houses and the spaces are just too big.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
You're sitting in the middle of a basketball court, you feel like...
Where are you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Uh-huh. And you have this great space at the very top there, which overlooks Lake Maspinock. Mm. And it's just, I've been up there, and it's a fantastic view. We couldn't bring the camera today because of the sun, but it's just a gorgeous top. Will it go any higher?
No, that's it. I've thought about putting a big, like, lifeguard seat up so you can, like, sit up another 12 feet.
That would be fun. Uh-huh.
Yeah, when the house across the street took our view of the lake away, we needed to sort of get it back, and that's what we had to do to get there. But it means you have to hike 3 flights of stairs to get there.
Uh-huh. That's good exercise.
It's good for the heart.
Yes, And even Bear goes up there?
He won't go all the way to the top. The spiral staircase stares him. I have friends who won't do the spiral staircase.
Yeah.
It's an outdoor spiral staircase on a deck.
Yeah,
and
it's just beautiful.
It's beautiful. And I haven't had anybody freeze yet, but I'm afraid at some point coming down, when you get to the top of that spiral staircase, you have a long view that goes like 30 plus feet down to the ground right in front of you.
Yeah.
And I'm expecting somebody at some point to panic and freeze there.
Yeah.
You know,
then you'll have to call the fire station.
Peel them off the staircase somehow.
No.
That hasn't happened. But I do have friends who won't go up there.
Well, it's a bit of adventure, like you.
Yeah.
And
it's up in the canopy of the trees, which is just a wonderful place to be.
Yeah, it's like a tree in a way.
Yeah. It was funny, I had an experience when I was building it one evening. I had a meeting to go to, but it was like 5 in the afternoon. I'm tired. And I just stretched out, spread eagle, on the deck. There was no railing up there at that point. I was just nailing the decking off on the very top. And I closed my eyes. I'm just in a wonderful state, trying to get a little relaxation, and I got strafed by 2 blue jays right across my chest and hit me in the chest, right across my face.
Uh-huh.
It was like, get out of our territory.
How about that? How often does that happen, huh?
Yeah, it was funny.
So, it's just fantastic. And not, in addition to what you have created from the small beginning of a little house, you also have this beautiful artistry all around the house, of the wood into the clapboards here.
Yeah, shingles.
The shingles.
Yeah.
Of herons and things in the wildlife around here.
Yes, there's... my wife used to say when we first started the project that doing stuff, do you want me to do any dovetails or inlays? Because she knows I could do that and it takes too much time. But when I got to the shingles, she kind of let loose a little and said, you know, if you want to do things, okay.
Go for it. Uh-huh.
And the shingles already, because of the railing system we did, carried some circle details around into the shingles as well to tie that together. And I've seen lots of shingle artistry before, and so I decided to even experiment and ad-lib a little and do birds and bats and design work, geometric designs. And
and you, including it into the stair, stairway as you walk up. All around the house, it's just beautiful contributions of art in addition to the carpentry. And we'll be able to show a few shots. But I also asked about some of the work you've done for other people. We can show maybe a picture or two and include that in this interview as well. But you have done some stunning work with wood, which seems to come very natural, in addition to the earth, your connection with wood, and how you can create beautiful things out of it, whether homes or images of art. How about the earth? We talked about how you feel at home here. You make the most of your setting here. You don't have to be at a resort somewhere, you've got it right here, but you care very deeply about the earth as well, and your activism work.
Yeah, I've always been an environmental activist, and I spent a lot of time in my 20s doing food co-op work, which also is about the politics of cooperating versus competitive models of capitalism, for instance. Mm-hmm. And we have a food system in this country that's, you know, based on profit. Mm-hmm. And so we don't always get the best food. And even if we're maybe the richest country in the world, our food system isn't designed for our health and well-being. It's designed for profit. And so I did that. I was involved in the Clamshell Alliance to try to stop the nuke at Seabrook, and also been to other places. I went out to Trojan and protested out there, out in Oregon State. And used to teach do nonviolent training sessions to form affinity groups. Worked with Mobilization for Survival at one point to do an Occupy Wall Street, and that was 35 years ago, maybe.
Wow, ahead of your time.
You know, still, those things are still being done, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm deeply concerned right now about, you know, what's happening with the planet. Pretty much burning the planet up, and if we don't change and figure out how to get to zero carbon, our grandkids aren't going to have the same planet. And life's going to be extremely different, and we've got massive refugee crises now around the world because of wars, but when you start flooding all the lowlands around the oceans where most people live, you know, we're going to have something much more catastrophic.
Yes. Yeah, and we don't talk about that enough.
No, the political climate in this country is just disgusting right now. The worst, we need to talk to each other. Republicans, Democrats, you know, Green Party people, we need to talk to each other and figure out how to move forward.
Absolutely.
And I always say we probably have the most to learn from the people that are least like ourselves.
Rather than putting a wall up from the people who are least. Yeah. Like ourselves.
And I think Scalia and Ginsburg are a great example for this country. We should follow their example. You know, Congress should always have dinners across the aisle with people and mix it up.
You got some good ideas there. Are you running for office?
No.
No, not for you. Not even in town?
Not even in town at this point, no. But, you know, I'm still involved in things.
Yes, well, it's obvious that you care deeply about the world. I know you have a son. Yourself, you think about, I would imagine, for the next generation.
The Native Americans used to think seven generations ahead.
Good.
That was a theme.
Yes, absolutely. In thinking about the seven generations of us, what have you learned about resiliency in life and the work you've done and the life you've lived that you could share with others of? You know, in story form or advice for future generations?
Well, I think we all have much more capability than we believe in ourselves. And, you know, examples of, like a child being underneath the car and a woman picking the car up to get her child out.
I remember that story.
Yeah. I mean, you would never think you would have that kind of strength, right? And I think we learn a lot from adversity. Having been through the Army, that's part of their training, is to give you a lot of adverse training so that hopefully you can endure whatever might come at you when you're in the Army, for instance. And it works. On some level, it works. It's not pleasant, but...
get through to the other side, and that we learn from it.
Yeah. I think even just things like, I ride a motorcycle, and I still ride in the winter. It could be 20 degrees, and I might go out for a ride. Most people put their motorcycles away. And, experiencing the intense cold and then warming the body back up. I mean, most of us try to live in a range of 70, 75 degrees all the time between our cars and our houses. And, you know, I think we're probably healthier physically if we expose ourselves to a bigger range of temperatures.
You're right.
And
that cold isn't so hard on us.
And the same thing mentally, you know, challenging ourselves. Sometimes dealing with awkward and difficult situations instead of walking away from them.
Well, see, now I think you should write a book. which is something that I care about. I love books, but yeah. I appreciate all of the advice and the wisdom I have been learning from you in this brief interview. Mm-hmm. I see we have about 2 more minutes left. And so I know you're contemplating retirement at some point. You have any thoughts about that, or is it far off in the distance and just a thought, or?
Yeah, I've been thinking about it. I belong to a couple of old men's groups in my church and sort of watching other people retire, and grew up sort of thinking that, of course, when you hit 65, you just retire. And, you know, money will come in the door in a form of a pension or something. Mm. Well, that doesn't happen. Mm-hmm. You know, days of pensions have disappeared. And, we could probably afford to retire now. I still enjoy what I do.
That's great.
And I have a very flexible boss, who's me.
Right.
You know, we took 5 weeks off this spring and went out to the desert southwest to see the cactus in bloom.
Uh-huh.
So I'll probably continue to just work a little less and try to work more at what I just really love.
That sounds like a great plan. And anything on your pre-retirement bucket list before we end? You've covered a lot of ground, I'd say, in your years at home, on the road, in your work, in your life.
Yeah. I don't know. There's just
Wait and see.
Yeah. Enjoy every day.
Enjoy every day.
You know.
Don't work to death.
I'm a morning person. Like, I can't help myself. I wake up at 4, 4:30. Yeah. I swim in the morning, often before sunrise, or go out on a boat. It's a nice time of day. Nobody wants me. Mm-hmm. And so I get to just be with nature and enjoy the beauty of this world. And
No, that's wonderful. Well, much great wisdom and experience that you've offered from your life. And I say congratulations for a life well lived. And thank you for what we are able to hear and learn from you today. Thank you so much.
Do you have what it takes?
Will you make a difference?
Always an adventure.
Police and fire working together.
Utilizing the latest technology.